much. Moderator Mabaseka, BBC President Sandy Lezungu, and the collective leadership, President of UDM, the spokesperson of the ANC, the policy head of the GA, President of the IFP, Minister of Women, and all important people gathered here, delegates. President Zungu, I also saw former leadership of BBC, Sevorasta, who was trying to do something similar to this. I don't know if you'll succeed. Let us begin with the obvious crucial question, and that is the post-1994 business regime has maintained and seek to maintain consistently the colonial role of black people in a predominantly white economy, which is to be male managers. The qualitative definition of a black manager, as it was under the colonization and apartheid regime, is the same today. A mere executive who manages the common affairs of the bourgeoisie, who are white racist. And this is a reflection in the forms of crisis which are facing our country today. The dependable and trusted Statistics South Africa told us that in the last quarter of 2019, more than 10.3 million people are unemployed and 1.3 million of them are black people. These are young people full of energy, willing and ready to work today. Even those that have looked for a job and have given up on looking. If there is an opportunity to work today, they will work. There are 8.1 million young people between the age of 15 and 34 years of age, people who are supposed to be transiting from dependency to the stage of independence, productive members of society, adding value to the country's GDP, but are not in education, training or employment. They are idle and doing nothing every day, and this is a sign of a serious crisis. The economy is not growing, instead it is going in the opposite direction, and this has been the case for many years now. There are those who are in denial about this reality. According to the Stats SA figures released on Tuesday, we are in a recession, not in a technical recession, Mr. Malema. This is a third recession since 1994, and we've had two of these recessions under the new dawn with investment envoy, investment summits, and investment pledges. All the sectors that are supposed to form the core of industrial policy suffered negative growth: manufacturing, electricity, gas, water, transport, communication, agriculture, and trade. Even government suffered a negative growth of 0.4%. Those who are responsible for growing the economy are living in their own bubble of hallucination and ignorance. The Minister of Finance says we have a strong economy and we will bounce back. The Governor of South African Reserve Bank says South Africa must listen to the Minister of Finance to avoid crisis. But the reality is that we can't listen to a minister who says nothing. The state-owned companies are even in much deeper crisis. Eskom, Denel, Transnet, Brasa, Waterboards, the SABC, and the list goes on. Eskom is in a serious and bigger threat to the fiscus and the South African economy. The collapse of Eskom will lead to unimaginable collapse of all of us in this country. Government has put guarantee of more than 480 billion with an exposure of almost 100 billion. Eskom debt guaranteed by government is more than 350 billion. This is 72% of total government debt guarantee. It means that Eskom collapse tomorrow, we must go to government budget and get 350 billion to pay the debt of Eskom. Last night, the Eskom board told the Standing Committee of Public Accounts in Parliament that they've got no plans, they don't even know where the money will come from to service this debt. There is no guarantee that there will be electricity tomorrow. You cannot even start the small business because even the smallest business needs electricity. We are told that there is a turnaround strategy in Denel, but Denel is also in crisis. revenues are declining in Denel. We have realized that Denel has lost almost 1 billion, and we are going to lose more. There is no clear turnaround strategy. We have seen under the new law more than 700 million of rand invested in research being reduced to mere 100 million. How do you compete for international contracts in innovation spaces where you are sitting with all the research and in very beneficial relationship with institutions like CSIR? This is happening under the new law. If it was Zuma withdrawing all of these investments in research and all those types of things, they would have said he's uneducated and doesn't appreciate the need for research. These are the people who claim to be educated and appreciate the importance of research and innovation, yet reduce resources for such initiatives. BRASA is looted. There is nothing left in BRASA except the name BRASA. We are having a situation where BRASA electricity is cut not because there is load shedding, but because BRASA is simply failing to pay electricity. And this leads to hundreds of workers, domestic workers, petrol attendants, teachers, stranded in areas like Cape Town. And those are the people who have bought tickets, monthly tickets. And if the trains are not moving, they've got no alternative because they've invested all of their money in those monthly tickets. Minister of Transport heard for the first time that the BRASA budget will be reduced when he was listening to the budget speech in Parliament, which means that even the new dawn doesn't plan collectively. They do not know what they are doing. We have a problem of lack of transformation in the economy. And this economy which is not growing, it is wide open. This economy which is not producing jobs, it is wide open. It is not owned by black people. But there is no serious criticism of it because it is wide owned. Imagine if this economy was to enter recession if it's owned by black people. Will be referred to as another failed African state. But if it is wide owned and enters recession, all types of nice names are found to justify why we are in a recession. 90.5% of the total banking sector assets are controlled by Standard Bank, FNB, Absa, Capitec, FirstRand, and all of them are white-owned and controlled. The insurance sector, forget, there's no even significant space for black people. It is white-owned, and they collude because they sit in different boards. You find the CEO of my way sitting in a board of Santa, yet they say they are two competing companies. We have a problem of manufacturing in South Africa, and even what is called manufacturing in South Africa is actually not manufacturing, it is assembly. Because vehicle manufacturing, which accounts for more than 85% manufacturing output, is white foreign owned. So things come from outside to Mercedes-Benz South Africa and they get assembled here and we are told that is manufactured. It is not true. VW, Toyota is Japanese owned, VW is German owned, Ford is American owned. Whatever assembling they are doing here, it means it is produced in their countries and it produces jobs for their people in their countries and only to come to be assembled here in South Africa. The same thing in agriculture. For those of us who are involved in agriculture, every time when we go to livestock auctions, you will find white people selling to each other the livestock. Because even if we go, we are just spectators, we do not have the necessary resource to compete with them. We are facing a serious problem of unemployment, poverty, and inequality because the economy, it is not transformed. 800 billion state procurement budget benefits white companies. Everything that the state procures, you are guaranteed that BigTest is going to be one of the biggest beneficiaries of such procurement by the state. The chief procurement officer at Eskom was telling Parliament Scopa last night about procurement transactions done through deviations, and all of them were with white-owned companies. There are some of the biggest state contracts done through sole source supply and deviation without anyone looking. In Eskom today, the white COO and the white CEO, they are engaged in sole sourcing supply, which is targeting strictly white companies. All those black companies which were in BEE deals with white companies under Brian Malema are told that those joint ventures are no longer applicable, giving the COO or even the CEO an opportunity to source from those white companies without the previous obligations which were entered into before. The new CEO of Eskom came with four companies to Eskom. He's not 6 months in Eskom. He came with four white-owned companies. And he said it yesterday with Scopa in Parliament that we have brought these four companies to come and help us in Eskom. These are the companies that are preparing, you know, the specifications in terms of the tenders that are going to take place in Eskom. After compiling those specifications, they are themselves going to tender for the same tenders that they prepared specifications for. These companies, the CEO of Eskom has given them to supply chain without following the due process. But we were told that these wires are brought into Eskom to come and correct the corruption of black people. It is the same arrangement we've seen with the Guptas. The state capture tells us today that the Guptas were hand-picking companies to state-owned enterprises. The white CEOs are doing the same things as the Guptas, bringing companies without following the due process. I'm telling you this information, which is a public information. You do not know about it because this corruption is conducted by white people. It is not corruption when it is done by white people. Can you imagine if Brian Malema had gone with four companies and said these four companies that are black owned are going to help us to transform Eskom? It is not something that is in the headline because it is committed by a white CEO. We must reclaim our economy. And there cannot be a reclaiming of the economy without a fundamental change. The white people tell you that the way you want to go about it, you are going to disrupt and collapse this economy. But the reality is, and maybe I'm speaking to the black elite, many of you have gone through renovation of houses. You know what happens when you renovate a house. There is disruption. There is no way we can transform this economy without disrupting this economy. We need to expropriate our land without compensation. Because when they came here and took our land, they never paid any compensation. It was taken through black genocide. It will not be for the first time that the state becomes a custodian of critical resource in South Africa. We know that the state is a custodian of mineral resources in South Africa. These mineral resources were before owned by private companies. And the state adopted a policy that made the state a custodian of mineral resources. We are now calling for the state to be a custodian of a natural resource called the land. It is not different from the mineral resources. That which we are calling for was done before through mineral resources. And when we say let the state be the custodian of the land, we do not mean that the Van Gonder who owns a farm there is going to be taken from Van Gonder. Van Gonder will own that farm even when the state is the custodian of the land. And he will only own it if he continues to do what is the purpose of that land. The day he stops farming, he loses that land that is given to a person who's prepared to continue farming in that land. Loses a house, you continue to own that house for as long as it is used for residential purposes. But once you turn it into a massage parlor, it is no longer serving its people. Therefore, it must be given to a person who will use that land for the rightful purpose. This message, they understand it very well. They deliberately distort it. They even want to accuse those who are advocating for land expropriation without compensation, they want to accuse us for this recession. If we are in a recession because people can't trust the ownership of the land by black people, then let it be. Because when the land is owned by white people, there is no recession. But when it is owned by black people, it will lead into a recession. And you all join them and say, let's own the land because it will cause a recession. Because black is what causes a recession. We must never accept that explanation. We are equally capable to own an economy. We are equally capable to own the land. And therefore, there is no investor who must suspect us on the basis of the color of our skin. Because if you do the color of the skin to determine whether you are going to invest or not, then you are a racist investor who has got no place in South Africa. Would rather shrink in a recession than to benefit from the proceeds of a racist investor who does not want the rightful owners of this land to participate meaningfully in the ownership of the economy. We want the uniform produced for nurses, for police, for soldiers, for patients in hospitals, for prisoners. Everything that has got uniform in this country and is owned by the state, that uniform must be produced in South Africa. We must have a clear policy about that. We cannot have traffic cops wearing a uniform that is written proudly produced in China, yet you say this is a patriot, a police officer looking after the interests of South Africa, wearing a proudly Chinese uniform. It's an insult to all of us as South Africans. And I don't understand why our government cannot take a simple policy position that says the food we are going to eat in hospitals, in prisons, in schools, those food are going to be produced from the farms from South Africa. And if we are going outside, we'll go to Africa. Only when we fail in Africa, we'll go and try somewhere else in the world. We need to stabilize Eskom. We can talk all of this, but if we cannot stabilize Eskom, we are finished, because all of this will require electricity. These independent power producers, we must scrap them. They are the few elite that are connected to President Ramaphosa, to Patrice Motsepe, to former Minister of Energy, Jeff Hardy. We need to scratch them. Who said that? Who said Eskom cannot produce an alternative energy? If there is a need for an alternative energy, why can't we capacitate Eskom to do the same? Instead of outsourcing this responsibility and giving to the family of the president, we had a problem here of a family called the Gupta's. We shouldn't create another problem of a family called Patrice Motsepe's family. We must be able to say, these things must be able to benefit our people, and the only way it can benefit our people, it is when it is stage old. We have no problem with the Patrice Motsepe or his family. We are disagreeing on the approach. And because in South Africa, when you criticize each other, you confuse that for hatred, because we suffer from self-hatred. We don't hate ourselves. We criticize one another because we don't want parties to fall under the same category as the Gupta's. He should not make such a terrible mistake as a good businessman who will later be destroyed by the simple things that we should actually let go. Patrice should appreciate that his proximity to the president and being the brother of the wife of the president should take a little bit of a back seat, particularly when it comes to issues that involve the state. Because even if he wins them fairly and swiftly, we'll always suspect that this one is a things will be better. It looks like we're going into a serious crisis. We have delivered the country into the hands of the Ruperts and the Oppenheimers. Whether you agree with me or not, I don't care. Because I won Robert the Guptas in 2011. You only came to the party 4 years later. I know that the EFF is always ahead. And we are very patient with you. You always catch up later. I'm telling you now, we are controlled by the Ruperts. We are controlled by investors. We are controlled by the Oppenheimers. They have deployed Pravin to look after their interests. They told Zuma right on his face the day he removed Pravin. It's not a joke. They went to him and said, we will collapse this thing if Pravin doesn't come back. And when those white CEOs went to tell Zuma to reinstate a minister, it was not a state capture. It was not business interference. The white owners of the economy told Zuma that if you remove this one, you don't reinstate this one, we will collapse this economy, we'll take that which belongs to us and leave. Johan Rupert made a similar remarks here, that if D.D. Mabuza becomes the president of South Africa, he will be left with no option but to take what belongs to him. He's in a way telling you who you should elect. You are being told and dictated to by white monopoly capital who should become the next president. And knowing these ones of my relatives in the ANC, they are likely to listen to what Rupert says because they are scared of white capital. We must never be scared of white capital if we want to transform the economy. Coming to you, black business, you seem to be extremely comfortable to manage the economy of white people. Many of you do not engage critically against the status quo with the hope that you will be called upon to serve in a particular board or to chair a particular board. You want to be in good books. At the same time, you claim to be advocating for transformation in business. You will never transform it if you are going to sweep talk the status quo. The only way you are going to radical position and standing fair on that position. You rather die with your boots on. You cannot be these flexible people who are unprincipled, always seeking to be politically correct. Leaders who seek to be politically correct represent nothing. They are actually political amoebas. They are shapeless. They change form and shape as they go along. The EFF's year, the theme of the year is a year of action against the racist financial sector in South Africa. It is racist, all of it. because we are all profiled. Even Motsepe is profiled. By virtue of being a black African, we are all profiled. We are treated like we are criminals in South Africa. As long as it's a black person, extra measures are taken to see if you qualify for this law. If you die, and it is reported that you are dead, and even death certificate is supplied, more investigations are made to confirm if you are dead. Because you are a criminal even when you are dead, they can never trust you. We are being profiled. It had to take a black family to carry a dead person into an old mutual offices in Durban to show them that indeed this person is dead, because death certificate is not enough for financial services to be provided for black people. So we can talk anyhow we want to talk. Without a radical stand, we are going nowhere. We want to depend on white people to transform the economy. You even want the market view. You want the rating agencies to come and tell you, who are these rating agencies? Who are the markets? Those are the same people you want to take over from. And you say to them, we want to come and take over from you. Help us to take over from you. It will never happen. The EFF last year has taken a decision to establish a private school from grade 0 to grade 12 owned by the EFF. Why? Because we realize that black people with money do not own schools. They private jets. They're private resorts. They've got game farms, but they do not own schools. It takes less than what they own to just build a private school. And after this resolution, I've not met Patrice because I wanted to ask him, why are you not owning a school? Even if you name it after yourself, it's your money. Why are you not owning a private school that you just take black people there and educate them? Why? Because education is critical and is at the center of everything we're speaking about. Two things they denied us. They took the land and they took proper education from us. If we can correct those two, we'll be able to stand on our own. A school owned by the EFF, guess what happened after we make an announcement? A white man comes and says, I want to give the EFF 10 hectares piece of land so that you can build a school. It's a very powerful idea. In response to him, I said, we do not want a free land from the white man. We want to buy it. So that if this school becomes an excellent, powerful, successful school, should not have a print of a white man. Because the idea is that everything successful must have a white person. And that's what I want to lead a project without a white man's blueprint, and I want it to succeed so that from the beginning and the end, there is no white man who has made any contribution. But if they come, they will come as employees and will pay them. Thank you.